Should you hydrate your hair? From all of the hydrating products out there, you'd think the answer is obviously yes. But is it all a lie? There's quite a lot of hair experts, including scientists, who say that water is bad for your hair, it causes damage. But that's not really true either. Water and hydration is one of the most confusing topics in hair science. It's one of the biggest sources of hair myths, not just from marketing and regular people, but also hair experts and cosmetic scientists. But once you understand it better, a lot of things about your hair and how to take care of it will start to make a lot more sense. I've been avoiding this topic because it's really complicated and I didn't feel like I could explain it properly, even with a chemistry PhD, even with a cosmetic chemistry diploma, even after bleaching the crap out of my hair. But we are finally doing it. Here is the real science behind hair and water. Have you ever noticed that when your hair is wet, it's stretchier? If you have long hair, it's probably pretty obvious. If you don't, ask a friend for a few pieces to play with. Dry hair is stiffer. If you stretch it too much, it breaks. It doesn't spring back. Wet hair is bendier. It's easier to stretch, but if it stretches, it will spring back. That's because the inside of your hair is really sensitive to water. Your hair is made of proteins, and all of this protein is stuck together with bonds. Bonds give your hair its strength and its shape. There are permanent bonds that only really break with chemical treatments, but there are also lots of temporary bonds, mostly hydrogen bonds. Water is really good at breaking these. When your hair is dry, these temporary bonds are sticking proteins to each other like glue. They are holding hands at a molecular level. But proteins can also hold hands with water, so if you dump a whole bunch of water into your hair, the proteins will start bonding with the water instead of bonding with each other. It's like you and your dog are at a dog park. Yes, the puppies are coming back. If it's just the two of you, you can only really interact slash bond with each other. He'll come when you call. But if you add a whole bunch of water, it's like you're adding a whole bunch of really friendly puppies. You interact with them. You're not going to have as strong of an interaction with your dog. You have a temporarily weaker bond. When the dogs leave, you have more interactions with each other again. You are more strongly bonded. So wet hair has less bonds holding the proteins together. It's a lot weaker, which is why it's so much easier to stretch. This is mostly why hair scientists say water is bad for your hair. It takes less force to break wet hair, so if you pull on it, a lot more strands will snap compared to if it was dry. It's like arm wrestling. You're going to win way more arm wrestles if you challenge people right after they just did arm day. But this isn't the only thing that water does to hair. Less bonds also means that the shape of curly or kinky hair gets looser. The shape is floppier, there are less tight bends. And just changing shape makes a massive difference. It's more damaging to comb straight hair when it's wet, it's weaker, and there's also more friction from water. But it's more damaging to comb curly hair when it's dry. When the shape is looser, there's less resistance, it's less prone to tangling. There's a bunch of studies showing this weird conundrum. If your hair is in between straight and curly and you're not sure if you should be combing it wet or dry, the science here pretty much just lines up with your personal experience. The one that needs less force, the one that's easier, is going to be less damaging. Wet or dry, conditioning your hair will also make it smoother, less force, less damage. But personal experience is way more misleading when it comes to other things that water does. Which is where we get into this whole idea of hydrating hair products. If you go to the store, you'll see tons of products that say hydration, hydrating. So do you think it's really obvious? More water in your hair makes your hair feel nice, soft, smooth, healthy. And this is one of the weirdest things that the whole hair care industry has kind of just agreed to do. I've been in hair lectures where scientists have said it's too hard to explain hydration properly to consumers. People won't believe you, they'll get confused, and they'll just buy someone else's products. So I'm going to try to do the opposite. I like making life harder for myself, obviously, but I think you can handle the truth.
Truth handler, you!
There is a sweet spot when it comes to how hydrated your hair should be. It's actually not that much different from skin. When your skin is too wet, if you've been sitting in the bath for ages, it gets fragile and it might crumble easily. But on the flip side, if it's too dry, then it's stiff and it cracks. But there are two big differences. Number one, it's a lot harder to adjust the level in hair with just products. And number two, the sweet spot for hydration with hair is a lot lower than it is for skin. Here's the thing. In studies, hair that feels nice and soft and smooth and healthy, and what we would think of as hydrated, it actually has less water than hair that feels rough and dry and damaged. There's a famous study where scientists asked people to rate hair with more water and less water, and most people said that the one with less water, it felt more moisturized, it felt smoother, less tangled, and less damaged. So why does hair with less water feel nicer, but then your hair feels nicer when you wash it and when you use so-called hydrating products? Let's start with the first bit, why hair with more water feels worse, and again, we're going back to bonds. When you have extra water slash puppies in the hair, it starts swelling up, and different parts of your hair will swell up different amounts. It's like the puppies like hanging out in particular bits. If we zoom in to the cuticle scales on the surface of your hair, those are those overlapping roof tiles, the underneath of each scale and the glue in between the scales will absorb water a lot more than the top. So the scales stick up a lot more, the surface feels bumpier and rougher. Water itself is also sticky. If you have one of those grocery bags and you can't open it, you can wet your fingers a little bit, not too much, and get more grip. So when the hair has more water in it, the surface gets bumpier and grippier on a microscopic level. And to us, that makes it feel like it's dry because most things don't go rough and bumpy when they're wet. With skin, for example, moisturizing makes it softer and smoother. So what most hydrating hair products are actually doing is conditioning. They are depositing an oily layer on the surface, and this is made of ingredients like silicones or fatty alcohols. This makes your hair feel smoother and it protects it, it makes it less sticky. Less of that friction makes it feel soft and smooth. Our hair actually starts off with a natural conditioning layer. It's called the F layer. It's sort of like a really thin oily layer that sits on top of each cuticle scale. As your hair gets damaged, this layer comes off, and a large part of what conditioners are doing is they're essentially replacing that F layer. Now here's where it gets misinterpreted slightly by people who do know a bit about hair science. You might have seen people say things like, conditioner seals hair against water, conditioner flattens the cuticle and prevents water from absorbing, effective conditioners actually stop hair from being hydrated, healthy hair is waterproof. All of this is not really true. If you wet undamaged hair, it can absorb about 30% of its own weight in water in minutes. That is a third of its own weight, which is quite a lot. And the reason is, if you look at the structure of hair, the F layer is just sitting on top of each cuticle scale. But the underside and the stuff in between the scales, the CMC, these are really good at absorbing water and it lets it inside the hair. There are just tons and tons of gaps. Your hair is basically like a pine cone. It is gap central. Conditioners stick to hair in little blobs, not one continuous layer. These blobs are small enough that the hair feels soft and smooth when we touch it, but individual water molecules are really, really tiny. They are getting in between the blobs. The blobs also aren't really sticking the cuticle down or sealing it. They are just tiny blobs. But you might be thinking, there are some tests where it looks like undamaged hair is waterproof. What's going on there? Let's break it down. Here's one example. If you put a drop of water on undamaged hair, it stays in a nice round bead. But on damaged hair, the water drop sort of flattens out and it looks like the water is absorbing into hair. Another one is the hair porosity test. You put a strand of hair in water. If it's less damaged, it floats. People will say it's less porous. But if it's more damaged and it sinks, then it is more porous. So if it's not about water absorbing into hair, what exactly is happening? Well, this is actually all about surface tension. It's happening because of how water is clinging to the outside of the hair, not whether or not it gets inside. The way most people explain the strand test is that hair sinks when it's absorbed enough water, so if it's more porous, more holes, the water gets in faster and it sinks. But the thing is, hair is already denser than water. You can actually do a similar test with a paperclip. If you're careful, you can get it to float on water. Even though metal is denser, it should sink. If you poke it or if you add a drop of detergent, it sinks even though the metal paperclip didn't absorb any water. So both hair and the paperclip are dense enough to drop down already. They'll sink if you disrupt the surface tension. In a glass, the water molecules, which are the blue blobs, they really like holding hands with each other. The ones at the top don't have friends on top, so it's like they have extra hands that have to grab along the surface, and all this bonding, all this grabbing, forms a sort of strong skin that can hold things up like hair and paperclips. Normally the oily F layer doesn't like water, it's not going to hold hands with it, but if you get rid of it, then you have a surface that actually likes water, it can hold hands. So the water molecules at the top hold hands with the hair, and so you get less of that surface tension, you don't have a skin, the hair sinks. This test still mostly works because surface damage does largely line up with other types of damage, which affects how easily other things get into hair, like hair dyes, but it isn't actually measuring porosity in the way that you might think. Same with the water drop. If you have damaged hair, it absorbs somewhere around 45% of its own weight in water, which it isn't actually that much more than the 30% for undamaged hair. So the water here isn't soaking inside of each hair strand, it's just spreading along the surfaces and in between the hairs. So at this point you might be thinking, hang on, Michelle, If all of this water is holding hands, there's all this surface tension, how is that 30% or 45% of water getting inside the hair? It's because it's not liquid water, it's gas. So if you think back to high school science, liquids are holding hands, they have things like surface tension, but with gases, the water molecules are individual, they're far apart, they're separated, they're not close enough to hold hands, there is no surface tension. If it's humid enough, which it is if your hair is wet, these molecules are small enough that they can wiggle in between those cuticle scales into the hair, there's no surface tension getting in the way. Now back to the second question, if hair with more water in it feels rougher, then why does hair feel nicer after you wash it? Well, the first reason is that water is really good for spreading stuff. It's way easier to spread conditioner and water evenly all over your hair compared to just spreading a much smaller amount of product which has no extra water to help out. The second reason is water is really good at resetting the shape of your hair. I think we all know this, if you've heat styled your hair, it's gone after you wash it, or if it's a really humid day, whatever styling you do just gets undone a lot faster. This is because heat styling is about breaking the temporary bonds with heat, pulling your hair into a particular shape and then setting it, which is just letting new temporary bonds come in and hold the new shape. But when water gets into your hair, it breaks the new temporary bonds and the permanent bonds will pull your hair back into the original shape. When you wash your hair with lots of heat and water and shampoo, which drops the surface tension, it is really good at breaking lots of temporary bonds. Your hair is in a super floppy state and that gets styled much more easily than usual. It's kind of like candle wax, the more soft and liquid it is, the more flexibility you have to shape it. There's an extra element if you have curly or coily hair. Water is really good at getting strands to align so that they're parallel. Again, this is the magic of surface tension. If there's water coating the outside of the hair, it's sticky. If you have two wet strands touching, the water can kind of just zip the two strands together. This is called self-assembly. It's a whole thing in supramolecular chemistry. It's really cool. So water helps curly hair clump together, which means they can dry in these nice curl formations. And this can actually make your hair feel more hydrated. When it's dry, these clumps have a bigger surface area that touches your hand, so heat gets transferred faster. They feel colder and smoother than if your hair wasn't so aligned. It's a lot like how satin feels colder than a rougher fabric. Cold things feel kind of wet. It's like how sometimes you can't really tell if your laundry is still wet or if it's just cold. And this resetting can also happen on a microscopic level. If you dry hair too quickly, like with a hairdryer, the cuticle scales can dry unevenly and some bits shrink faster than others. You end up with buckling of the cuticle scales and your hair looks like this. This can also happen if your hair gets stretched a bit, about 15%, which is not that much. The way to reset this is with water. If you soak it in water, then the scales can sort of reset back into a smooth shape. Now you might be thinking, isn't this wetting and drying over and over again bad for your hair? This is a really persistent myth called Hygral fatigue. It's really ingrained everywhere, but there actually isn't that much convincing evidence that Hygral fatigue is actually a thing. The analogy I see is that wetting and drying your hair is like stretching a rubber band.
You do not want to wet your hair every day because if you are constantly wetting it and drying it and wetting it and drying it, it will eventually snap.
But for rubber bands, it's because you're stretching it so much that you're breaking permanent bonds. They can't actually form again. In hair, water is breaking temporary hydrogen bonds. These ones will reform really easily. So it's actually a lot more like joining and unjoining Lego pieces and not the knockoffs, the proper brand name ones. Except the atoms and hydrogen bonds are way more durable, the electrons and protons never wear out. Wet hair is more fragile though, so you do have more opportunity for it to get damaged if you're rough with it, but just having water going in and out isn't going to cause damage. There are a couple of papers that seem to say that Hygral fatigue is a thing, water itself can damage hair, but they aren't very good evidence. The first one is this study on hair drying. I talked about it in my hair drying video. The researchers concluded that air drying caused damage because water was swelling the hair for longer, but I don't think their explanation actually makes sense. Air drying is pretty standard everywhere. If it was causing the bulges they saw in that one little sample of hair, then other studies would be seeing a lot more bulges. So the bulges probably come from something else that happened to that specific sample. There are also a few studies on coconut oil that said it could potentially block water from absorbing, so it protects against Hygral fatigue, but they don't actually cite sources for Hygral fatigue being a problem in the first place. With coconut oil, a lot of people, including me in the past, have cited this study as a reason for why it might be good to use before shampooing. But another hair scientist, Trevor Evans, thinks this might essentially be a calculation error. In the experiment, they put different oils on hair and then let them absorb water. The weight of the coconut oily hair didn't increase as much. But it looks like they didn't take the weight of the coconut oil into account, so the same amount of absorbed water would look smaller as a percentage you are dividing by a bigger number. And coconut oil not sealing out that much water? This makes sense with hair structure. Every cuticle edge is a gap. It's just really unlikely that you could seal the whole pine cone against teeny tiny water molecules. And this is the case in general for hair products. It is just really hard to prevent tiny water molecules going in and out of your hair. The water content of your hair largely just depends on relative humidity, how much water is actually in the air around you. We already talked about how hair is weaker and rougher when it's wet, and this is also the case when humidity is high, just to a lesser extent. But having too little water also causes a bunch of other changes. If humidity is really low, your hair is too dry, and static builds up really easily, you get flyaways. That's because hair loses electrons when it rubs against stuff, but water can help spread that static charge out. So I always notice that my hair goes really staticky and awful on planes. The humidity there is just ridiculously low. Hair that's too dry is also more brittle, and this means it isn't stretchy and flexible enough. You want a little bit of flex because that absorbs shock. This is important when you are putting force on it when you're brushing it. Dry hair cracks more easily, including inside the hair, and when the cracks build up enough, that's when your hair breaks. This also happens with nails. If you clip your nails when they're dry, the cracks will keep traveling because the nails are more brittle. But if you do it after a shower, they're more wet, they're more flexible, the cracks will stop, they don't spread the whole way. So how do you get your hair into that sort of happy medium of hydration? Well, there are a few things that can help, or at least they can make your hair act like it has a more ideal water content. How exactly some of these things work isn't really settled. Bonding treatments, I know I need to do a proper video on these. A lot of them seem to work by sitting in your hair and stopping water from coming in and breaking a whole bunch of bonds. Small molecules like glycerin might be able to get into hair and act like water, or it could be potentially increasing humidity right next to the hair. There's a study that found that black hair at 65% humidity broke more easily than wet hair, and using humectants like glycerin stopped that from happening. Oils like coconut oil, the reason they might work is that they get into hair a bit and then they make it more flexible and less brittle. So at the end of all of that, water isn't actually good or bad. It is a tool, it can be used to basically soften hair structure. Whether that is good or bad depends on your hair and what you're trying to do to it. If you want hair that feels smooth and soft and, well, cold, you probably want to condition it and shape it so that it is smoother and the strands are more aligned. It doesn't actually matter if your product actually says hydrating. You don't need to worry about water damaging your hair, you don't need to avoid washing your hair or using products with water in them, just to try to avoid this whole concept of Hygral fatigue. But you do need to make sure you treat your hair gently when it's wet, so use lots of conditioner if you're trying to detangle it, whether it's wet or dry. Hair science is really complicated and water is really complicated. I have barely scratched the surface here. There are like a million things like that coconut oil thing that you have to sort through when you're reading studies and looking at methodology. Back when I was writing my book, I wanted to make a video that was just called Hair Science is a Mess and this shampoo video was what happened, but that is now kind of turning into 10 videos. My hair science playlist is there if you want to go further down that rabbit hole.